One of the biggest questions I get as a cash flow expert is, how do I get out of debt once and for all? Well, watch this to the end for the answers that have worked for me every single time, as well as hundreds of our clients. Number one, and this is just the basic stuff to start doing if you want to get out of debt right now, is start tracking your money. So many times people say, well, I got to live on a budget, but then they hate the budget, right? The budget's just horrible for them. Guys, the budget is step two. It's the next thing you do beyond that. But most people in my experience have never really tracked their money. They don't track the money coming in, the income, and they don't really track the money going out, which are your expenses. The best thing you start doing is tracking your money on a weekly, if not at least every other week basis. So for example, a great tool that I love to use is called Mint. Mint.com, like double your pleasure, double your fun with extra double mint gum, right? Mint is a great tool to use. It's free for one. And then two, it actually connects to your bank safely and securely, connects to your bank and allows those balances and those transactions to come through. But what's so hard is, I remember back in the day when I tried to track my money, they'd say, well, just get out a ledger. You know, for those of you old enough, you know what these are, like check ledgers and things like that. You get out your ledger, and you write every little deposit and every withdrawal and all that kind of stuff. And then you have to do your own math. And if you stink at math, you screw it up every time. And then you get a calculator. But what if you forget where you are, then you can't do it. These things get rid of all of that because it's kind of AI-ish, right? It makes it easier because they'll actually bring those transactions in for you. You just have to make sure they're categorized in the right places, and then it adds it all up for you and tells you where your money's going. And so when you start tracking your money, the first thing you want to do is eliminate those non-productive or destructive expenses. You know, get rid of those things, get rid of that membership that you forgot you're paying monthly on but you're not really using. Get rid of that stuff so then you have extra cash coming in. You want to make sure that there's more income coming in than your expenses, because that extra cash will help speed up your progress of paying off your debt faster. Again, now don't take this too extreme. Please do not go all Dave Ramsey on this and just go all living on rice and beans, being cheap, living out of a cardboard box. I'm not recommending that, right? You don't have to cut out every single latte for every single day. I'm not saying that. You know, what I am saying is be a wise steward of your money. Track it, figure out what's necessary and what's really worth it for you, and then react, you know, and then start changing those things. Then start finding ways to free up cash by tracking your money. So I definitely recommend using Mint as a tool right now to do that. Now, once you start to free up that cash, you have extra money to start doing it, one thing to help speed up the progress for you is looking at either refinancing or negotiate lower interest rates. Let me start with the latter, with negotiating lower interest rates. You can call up a credit card company and say, hey, can I get a lower interest rate on this? You know, I notice I'm at this rate, can I get a lower rate? It's possible. You could also do, if it's a credit card, do a balance transfer to another rate, to a lower rate. Maybe it's a 0% rate for some time. You could do that as well. In fact, you might even tell your current credit card company to say, hey, listen, I'm getting these 0% transfer offers right now. I would like to stick with you guys and not have to go through the hassle of that. Can we negotiate a lower interest rate so I can pay this off faster? And they may say yes, they may say no, but it's worth a shot, right? The same is also true when you're looking at auto loans, mortgages, maybe even student loans, is looking for ways to, if you can't negotiate a lower interest rate, look at a way to refinance. You know, now, I know with mortgage rates, some of you may not want to refinance right now, but it might make sense if it allows you to free up more cash so that you can still keep a decent interest rate and pay off the higher interest rate type of loans. Now, stick with me towards the end here, because there's a bonus tip about you don't always want to pay off the highest interest rate first. Be sure to hang with me here, because there is a difference here. There is some nuance to make sure this works. But definitely look at ways to refinance, ways that will help you free up that monthly cash, possibly even reduce your rates, and therefore allowing you to be able to pay these things off faster, or at least pay off the ones that are more necessary faster to give you a better bang for your buck. Now, number three, this is a big one. I see this a lot. People make this mistake, is they try to put a little bit extra every month to all their loans and their credit cards and such. Don't do that. Pay off one at a time, just one. Focus it all there. It's kind of like if you want to put out a fire. Do you want to really just use a little garden sprinkler that's shooting out little different ways, like, or do you want a fire hose to go right into it, right? We want the fire hose. Do the same thing. I know you feel like you might not make progress, but believe it or not, people actually make better progress paying off just one at a time. So focus on that one, and then go for the next one later. Do that little debt snowball where you pay off one, take that payment, roll into the next one. And you take that payment after you pay that one off, and take all that money and pay it to the next one, and you just do that little debt snowball. Another bonus tip here, okay? This bonus tip is do not make extra payments on mortgages, car loans, or student loans. So when I talk about making extra payments, when you get down to paying off one loan at a time, do not make extra payments per month on those mortgages, car loans, or student loans. Why? Because when you put an extra payment on a mortgage, a car loan, or student loan, Those kind of loans do not decrease their payment as you pay those down. The payment stays the same. If you pay on a mortgage and it's, say, $1,500 a month, and you're paying that sucker down, it's still at $1,500 a month until you get it paid off completely. Here's the risk. Many people will put all their money to paying these loans down, and if you're midway in that progress and you don't have a bunch of cash reserves, what happens? Something goes wrong, there's an unexpected expense, or you lose your job, maybe you lose your income or something like that. Next thing you know, you can't get that money back out. I made this mistake in the last recession. I was putting extra money onto my mortgage, believing if I ever needed the money, I can always just cash the money back out. I can go to the bank and ask, can I get a cash out refinance and get that money? Because I figured, hey, right now they're giving mortgages to anybody with, you know, a heartbeat and a decent credit score. But guess what? Summer of 2007, when I went in to actually go get money out, because I started to see the winds of shifting that was going on in the economy, they said, you know what? We're not so sure we want to give you that money. Why don't you bump up your score 2 more points? And so I did. I came back the next month. They said, good job. Way to bump up your score. You even went up more than 2 points. But you know what? Do these things first. And then by September of 2007, when I came in, I said, I've done everything you guys have asked. Let's get this done. They said, we're sorry. We just don't give loans to people, especially if you're a business owner. You don't want to be caught in that kind of trap. I made all these extra payments onto that mortgage, could not get the equity out. And then what happened when all the debacle happened with the real estate, values came down, the equity was gone anyways. I had $150,000 trapped in equity that I could not get out of my house. Guys, it would be much better to have that money in cash. So here's what you do. So you build up that cash in your savings account. When the balance of your savings account gets bigger, that's the key thing, bigger than the mortgage or the car loan or student loan you're trying to pay off, then you pay it off. Don't use every last dollar to pay it off. Every time I've done that and every time one of our clients have done that, like clockwork, some emergency comes up and you want that money back again. So when the balance of your savings gets much bigger, you know, significantly bigger than what the balance is on those loans, and they are coming down because you're paying principal as it goes. So it's almost like they're doing this. Once it gets bigger, then use that cash to pay it off and you still got a little bit of cash buffer left over. So do that. All right, so here's the one thing that people always ask. They say, well, which one do I pay off first? How do I know? Do I pay off the highest interest rate? Do I pay off the lowest balance? Like, you know, I know Dave Ramsey teaches. The answer is neither of those. In fact, I'm gonna give you something that might be a little extra bonus tip that you wouldn't expect. Ignore the interest rates. It doesn't matter as much. I first learned this as a traditional financial advisor where I developed this nice little program. It was an Excel program back in the day that took forever to run numbers. And when we put the numbers in Excel program with all these debts, what shocked me is that if you wanted to pay off debt the fastest, what was interesting is that sometimes it would be a lower interest rate loan, let's say, to pay off first, because it wasn't based on the interest rate. The interest rate's not what's really killing you. It's really the monthly payments. And what does that do for you? So here's what the cash flow index is. You take the balance of the loan, divide it by the minimum monthly payment, and you'll get this index. The key is this, the lower the index, the more you wanna pay it off. For example, say you have a $10,000 credit card that has a $200 a month payment. 10,000 divided by 200 is 50. But let's just say you also have a $10,000 auto loan that's at 500 a month. Well, 10,000 divided by 500 is 20. Now you might think, well, that auto loan is a cheaper rate. Why wouldn't I pay off the credit card first? Because that's what everybody tells me to do. That's true, everybody will tell you that. However, the thing that gives you more freedom allows you to pay down debt faster, because remember, your life wasn't always meant to be put in a calculator. There are still other factors that can happen. And let's put some common sense to this. If something happens where your income drops or your expenses go up for any particular month, do you wanna keep paying 500 a month or 200 a month when things get tight? Naturally, you wanna pay 200 a month. That's real life. Life can come at you fast, right? As some of the insurance commercials will say. So what we do is we pay off the $500 a month, that car loan, even if it's a lower rate. We pay that off first, because now we have that 500, we can actually apply that credit card and now make it a 700 payment, which will pay off within a year anyways. So we can actually take that money and pay it off faster. The interest is kind of negligible, because really that extra interest, it doesn't charge that much over the next year. So what I've noticed is that the interest rate doesn't really matter. Now, if there's a tie between two loans, say they have the same cash flow index, then you go for the highest interest rate. Then you pay that sucker off first and then move on to the next one. So you just do the debt snowball method by paying the lowest cash flow index first, roll up to the next highest one. Especially if that index is below 40, focus on paying those off. Now, if it's higher, you might look at ways of doing what I mentioned earlier, refinancing. You know, for example, a mortgage, I like to get the mortgage to over a 200 if you don't count taxes and insurance. You know, get it over a 200 index, things like that. Just really making it easier for you to be able to pay off those loans faster, so then you can get to those lower interest loans like your student loans or your mortgages. What's amazing is that so many people think that they gotta pay off that student loan right now, But in many cases, those student loans are actually one of the highest indexes and should be put to the back burner and focus on the other ones first, and then you can move to the student loans later. So guys, that's the key right there, is use that cash flow index. It will save you so much money, even help me pay off over $1 million of debt in really about less than 10 years just by doing that method alone. So guys, if you think this is cool, check out this next video, how to make $5,000 a month in passive income. Check it out.